Ephesians chapter 15. We're going to continue looking at the passage here, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, specifically verses 21 and verse 22, okay? And what we're doing is we're looking at the resurrection timeline, okay? So let's read the passage, and then we'll move on, just so that we have a feel for the immediate context, okay? Let's read verses 19 down through verse 28. It's not an overly large section, but that way we get a feel for what the Apostle Paul here is seeking to achieve. Verse 19, if in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men most miserable. But now is Christ risen from the dead, and become the first fruits of them that slept. For since by man came death, by man came also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. But every man in his own order, Christ the first fruits, afterward they that are Christ at his coming. Then cometh the end, when he shall have delivered up the kingdom to God, even the Father, when he shall have put down all rule and all authority and power. For he must reign till he hath put all enemies under his feet. The last enemy that shall be destroyed is death. For he hath put all things under his feet. But when he saith all things are put under him, it is manifest that he is accepted, which did put all things under him. And when all things shall be subdued unto him, then shall the Son also himself be subject unto him that put all things under him, that God may be all in all. Father, again, we do thank you for your love and grace. We thank you for the hope that you give to us, the believer, today, knowing that not only are our sins eternally forgiven, not only do we have that eternal place and position in your beloved Son there in the heavenly places, but we certainly rejoice knowing that one day we are going to receive that glorified body that equips us to be useful and functional out there for all of eternity. We pray that that hope would sustain us, as we know many of our dear brothers and sisters are going through very difficult times right now, physically, emotionally, and psychologically. We pray that you, as the God of comfort and the Father of mercies, would provide that sustaining comfort and strength because of your grace. And we do ask it all in Christ Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to pick it up. Let me just briefly again review. Oh, good. Everything else is working. Hopefully now we're good to go. Real quick, I drew this resurrection timeline. And as a reminder, don't fret, but the Apostle Paul is going to be referring to prophecy. And he does so in relationship to resurrection. Don't get nervous, because Peter and the other apostles, they too preach the issue of resurrection, okay? So with that in mind, obviously the Lord Jesus Christ, he is crucified. He's resurrected from the dead. The Apostle Paul calls Jesus Christ and his resurrection the first fruits, okay? Then we learn, if you notice there at verse 23, but every man in his own order, Christ the first fruits, afterward they that are Christ at his coming, okay? So on the timeline, we'll go to Revelation chapter 20 to demonstrate this, but after the tribulational period, after the 70th week of Daniel, there is a resurrection that's going to occur when the Lord Jesus Christ comes back in kingdom power and in kingdom glory, okay? So that is identified as number two, all right? That's the resurrection of the righteous. They're the ones, the Old Testament saints, they're going to be resurrected, and they're the ones that will enter into the kingdom. And when we study Revelation chapter 20, we recognize that there is a 1,000-year interim period of time. In fact, let's go to Revelation chapter 20. I don't think we're going to, you know, dig deeply here in the passage this morning, but all I want you to do is be familiar with this resurrection timeline, all right? Revelation chapter 20. And six times the Apostle Paul here in this chapter refers to a 1,000-year period of time. We call it, or it is often described as, the, quote, millennium, milli, thousand, annum, annual year, okay? So when you hear the language, the millennium, That's that 1,000-year period of time that Revelation chapter 20 is talking about. Now, probably in the future, we'll demonstrate that this is talking about a literal period of time. You have amillennialists, and anyway, you have doctrines out there that would teach that this is all figurative and should not be understood as literal. Okay, we reject that. We believe when the passage talks about 1,000 years, it is referring to a literal 1,000-year period of time. So six times we have that language, okay? And again, we're not going to dig into what's happening, but if we pick it up at verse 4, okay? Revelation chapter 20, verse 4. And I saw thrones, and they sat upon them, and judgment was given unto them. And I saw the souls of them that were beheaded for the witness of Jesus and for the word of God, and which had not worshipped the beast, neither his image, neither had received his mark upon their foreheads or in their hands, and they lived and reigned with Christ 1,000 years. Right off the bat, you and I are not even hinted at in this passage. This passage is specifically referring to some of the calamities, some of the activities that are going to happen in the tribulation. We, the body of Christ, are not in the tribulation, nor will the body of Christ ever experience the tribulation. We've been delivered from that period of time. Hence the parentheses, all right? When we draw the parentheses, just that symbolizes the dispensation of the grace of God, all right? We're in a parenthetical period of time in relationship to prophecy, all right? The 66 books of the Bible has as its overall purpose and emphasis God's purpose on the earth, what we, of course, recognize in the epistles of Paul, Romans through Philemon. This is a mystery program. This is a period of time that God never predicted. He never said anything to the prophets regarding what God is doing today. The reason I point that out is God's intention is to take up the church, the body of Christ, prior to the 70th week of Daniel, okay? We are delivered from that tribulational period. So when we read, for example, verse 4, don't fear, oh no, what if I receive the mark? What if I worship the beast? That is not something that we need to fear in this current dispensation of grace, okay? So, as we now notice the end of verse 4, these individuals that do not participate in the Antichrist program, all right, those individuals that are not worshiping the beast, so on and so forth, the end of verse 4, they lived and reigned with Christ for how long? 1,000 years, okay? Verse 5, but the rest of the dead live not again until the 1,000 years were finished. So there are two categories of people. Those that are going to reign with Christ for that 1,000-year millennial period of time. But then there's a second category of people, verse 5, but the rest of the dead live not again until the 1,000 years were finished. Okay? This is the first resurrection. So in other words, those individuals that are going to reign with Christ for 1,000 years, they participate in what the Bible calls the first resurrection. Okay? Now, we're not going to deal with it right now. When we think of first, we think of chronology, right? We think of first in order. We need to just be aware that Jesus in the book of Acts is called being raised first. So how can Jesus be first and yet here in Revelation we have the first resurrection? Just tuck it away in your thinking. First doesn't always have to mean in chronological order. First could also refer to type or kind, okay? There's the first type or kind of resurrection that's going to happen at the commencement of the thousand-year millennial reign of Christ. So the tribulation is over. Jesus Christ comes back in power and in great glory. And as Jesus begins to judge the nation, so on and so forth, there is this mass resurrection of all the Old Testament saints, as well as, of course, the saints during the earthly ministry of Jesus Christ. They're now raised, and they're going to reign with him for 1,000 years. But then there's a second resurrection, which, let's keep reading, verse 6, "Blessed and holy is he that hath part in the first resurrection. On such the second death hath no power. But they shall be priests of God and of Christ, and shall reign with him 1,000 years. And when the 1,000 years are expired, Satan shall be loosed from out of prison, and shall go out to deceive the nations." So something's going to happen after that 1,000-year millennial period of time. What's going to happen in addition to Satan being loosed, and then you're going to have the ultimate culmination of rebellion, Magog, so on and so forth. Drop down to verse 11. "And I saw a great white throne, and him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were open, and another book was open, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged." Now tuck that away, judgment, and we're going to explain why Jesus is going to raise everybody from the dead, okay? It has something to do with his right as the Son of Man to judge, okay? But anyway, so the dead were judged. Well, how do you judge a dead man? So, you know, think about it. How can the dead be judged? There's a resurrection that's going to happen. "Out of those things which are written in the books according to their works." Verse 13. "And the sea gave up the dead which were in it." By the way, I don't believe that to be the oceans and lakes on planet Earth. There's a sea out there, okay, in the universe. "And the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them. And they were judged, every man according to their works." This is a resurrection of the damned, okay? The resurrection of the damned, and we'll look at some other verses, the resurrection of the damned occurs after that thousand-year millennial period, okay? Sometimes people ask, well, wait a minute, I thought the kingdom is eternal. Well, yes, but every dispensation has a transitional period. In other words, why a thousand-year period of time? Satan is bound. The influence, the direct influence of Satan himself is removed from human history. And now humanity is left to make a decision. Are you going to worship the king there in Jerusalem, or are you not going to worship the king who is there in Jerusalem, the Lord Jesus Christ? So don't get bent out of shape. There's a strategic reason for a thousand-year period of time. But for our sake, after that thousand-year millennial period of time, there's going to be what is called the Great White Throne Judgment. That number three represents the resurrection of those that are damned, okay? So let's go back to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. So for now, the resurrection timeline, if you will, identifies Jesus Christ as the first fruits, as well as the resurrection that's going to happen at his coming. And although the Apostle Paul doesn't explicitly state there's this resurrection after the thousand-year millennial period of time, we know that he is referring to that third resurrection. Notice once again, 1 Corinthians 15 and verse 26. Okay, verse 26, "The last enemy that shall be destroyed is what? Death." That happens after the thousand-year millennial reign, okay? The elimination of physical death happens after the Great White Throne. So, on the resurrection timeline, there are three resurrections. Now, where do you and I come in as the church, the body of Christ, are we given the promise and hope of resurrection? The answer is yes. Is Paul referring to it directly in the timeline? He's not referring to it directly. So where are we on the timeline? Drop down to verse 51. Verse 51 of chapter 15. Behold, I show you a what? A mystery. By the way, resurrection is not a mystery. Elijah resurrected a boy. I mean, we're going to see there are a lot of passages where resurrection is taught, okay? Resurrection is not a mystery. And of course, in the Bible, when we come across the word mystery, it's not suggesting that it's, quote, mysterious, difficult to comprehend. It's so hard to understand. In the Bible, mystery it signifies something that wasn't known previously, all right? When something is a mystery, it's something that is kept secret. So Paul, when he says in verse 51, behold, I show you a mystery, he's not saying, man, I don't understand this. This is dark. This is difficult to understand. It's just hard to grasp. He's saying, I'm going to show you something that was secret, never before revealed. Okay, that's what Paul's writing here in verse 51. Behold, I show you a mystery. You, Corinthians, the Apostle Paul, by extension, all the believers for the last 2,000 years, from where we're at, year 2022, okay? We shall not all, what? Sleep. And remember, the word sleep is a gentle way of describing the physical state. It's not used to describe the soul. The souls are conscious. The soul are active. We saw a couple of verses last Sunday morning, okay? Sleep is a very fitting description of the physical state of the body. And you understand that. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be what? Changed. So relax. We can insert the body of Christ into or on the timeline because Paul's then going to add something that wasn't on the timeline before. Here's a secret. By the way, if this resurrection, and let's demonstrate it is a bodily resurrection. Verse 51, behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. For the trump shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. Okay? So it's obviously more than fitting to describe this resurrection that the body of Christ is going to experience as a mystery, a secret. Why? Because the entire dispensation of grace was a mystery. It was a secret. So we can insert ourselves onto this timeline knowing that this is a resurrection prophetic scripture knew nothing about. It was never referred to. It was a mystery until it was first revealed to the Apostle Paul. So we have first fruit resurrection. We have the first resurrection preceding the thousand-year reign of Jesus Christ. There is the resurrection of the dead at the end of the thousand-year reign of Christ at the great white throne judgment where death is ultimately vanquished. Okay? Then Paul's going to say, but I'm going to show you something. You can't go to anybody else in Scripture. I'm going to show you and I'm going to demonstrate we are also going to be changed. And that resurrection that the Apostle Paul is referring to is separate, distinct, and absolutely unique. He's not saying, oh yeah, we're going to participate at the resurrection when Jesus Christ comes back in power and great glory, okay? He's going to demonstrate this is a resurrection that delivers us from the 70th week of Daniel, okay? So that's the timeline that we're going to hopefully try to lay it all out this morning, okay? Now, real quick, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, last Sunday, I got a little bit of feedback, okay? Two individuals, which is half the internet audience for this class, they were a little bit unsettled. And they didn't freak out, panic, get all unglued. You know, they didn't come at me with, you know. But they were a little bit, unsettled. I made the statement, if we read verse 21 again, 1 Corinthians 15, verse 21, for since by man came death, by man came also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. I understand verse 22 to say, to teach, in Christ all, believer and unbeliever, are going to be made alive. And I know traditionally Paul, by the way, he uses the expression in Christ numerous times. In fact, you talk about Pauline language, a Paulism. Paul is really the only writer of the New Testament that uses the term in Christ more than anybody else in the New Testament. When we think of in Christ, we, more often than not, rightly understand that to refer to this positional union that we have in Jesus Christ, right? And I'm thinking, and here's a little, as I'm driving to church this morning, you know, I'm thinking, what would be a great way of maybe illustrating to be in Christ? Now, forgive me, I just thought of this about 45 minutes ago, okay? And it's a rough illustration, but you know what? Think about it. To be in Christ, the moment you trust Jesus Christ as your Savior, you understand, you know, I can't do it. I'm broken. I fail. I'm full of flaws. And you know what? I come to Him as I am, a sinner in desperate need of a Savior, okay? When we recognize, wait a minute, God is not exhorting a sinner to stop sinning and become a better sinner and get right. Rather, God offers the free gift of eternal life as we are in our dire, urgent need. All right, I'm a sinner. I can't do it. God says, that's right. You can't do it. By grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Right? So when you're at that place where there's nothing I can bring, there's nothing I can produce, there's nothing, I stand before a just, holy God as I am, absolutely condemned. God says, that's what I'm looking for. And if you trust Jesus Christ as the sole sufficient sacrifice for your sins, He did it all. And God says, don't you even participate in the work of my Son. You just rest. You just have your faith and confidence. Believe the claim of God. When God says, I put my Son as that sacrifice for you, believe what the Father says. And if you believe Jesus did that all for me, apart from anything I could ever do, in that instant, God the Holy Spirit places you into Jesus Christ. You don't, praise God, is right. You don't feel it. So how do you know it's true? That's what the verses say. See, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by. God could care less how you feel. I don't mean it that way. You know what I mean when I say that. The measure isn't what you feel about what Jesus. The measure is, what does God say happened? I remember when I was a kid and I got saved. I was just a kid. I was 8 years old. And I thought, you know, I trusted Jesus. I remember walking from church home, well, to the apartment building. And anyway, I trusted Jesus. I just remember doing it. And I thought, you know, lightning. And I thought, you know, the sky was supposed to open up. And nothing happened. I thought, well, maybe I'm not really saved. Now I'm an 8-year-old kid, okay? You come to realize, that's right. You're not going to have a ban, and the heaven's not going to open, and gold dust isn't going to fall down. You know how I know I was baptized into Jesus Christ? Because the verse says, I was baptized into Jesus Christ the moment I trusted Him as my Savior. Okay, how do we illustrate being in Christ. Again, rough illustration I just came up with it 45 minutes ago, okay? You know, you think about, have you ever done this with a kid? You know, if you took a bathtub full of water, and let's say you take a drop of red food dye, and let's say one drop of red food dye, and it lands into the tub of water, it lands into Lake Michigan. What happens to that droplet of red water? It's gone. It's absorbed into the body of water. So think about, Jesus is not a body of water, but just think about this. The Lord Jesus, who he is, his identity. The believing sinner, it's like a drop of water added to Lake Michigan. We are absorbed into his accomplishments, his achievements, his identity, all that he has secured for us. We don't become little deities, don't get me wrong, okay? We don't become God, but we are now in Jesus, absorbed into this positional union. Everything he possesses, I share. Everything I have, he shares. And by the way, we're absorbed into one living, loving, eternal identity as his body. By the way, that is the illustration that Paul uses. It's his body. We are all living, loving, eternal members of his body. So you talk about being absorbed into, I mean, you think about body parts, molecules, cells, and so on and so forth. We're all in Christ in a positional sense, absorbed into his identity. Everything that is his is mine, vice versa, okay? And that's a wonderful place to be, all right? So more often than not, when Paul uses the expression in Christ, we understand that rightly to mean in a positional union, okay? But that isn't the only way in which the expression in Christ is used. So let's read verse 22 again. For as in Adam all die, even so, here we go, in Christ shall all be made alive. Many read it to say, even so, all in Christ shall be made alive. Now you see, that's how most believers read verse 22. Well, when the verse talks about resurrection, all in Christ will be made alive. By the way, when the word alive is used, is the verse saying, in Christ all shall be saved? No. In Christ all shall be justified? No. In Christ all shall be what? Made. And what's the context of chapter 15? Bodily resurrection. So for those who may feel a little unsettled about what I'm about to say, regarding what I'm about to say, the issue is not universalism. The issue is not how God's going to save everybody or he's going to justify everybody or he's going to be. The context is bodily resurrection. In Christ, it doesn't say all in Christ shall be made alive, which is a true statement. You understand that. The thrust here is that Jesus Christ counters the effect of Adam's evil. In fact, maybe we'll go to Romans 5. Romans 5, when Paul describes Adam as a federal head, and then he describes Jesus Christ as the federal head, what Paul does in Romans 5 is he's focusing in on the spiritual ramifications of Adam's sin. Here, Paul brings up Adam and Christ again. Why? He's going to add something to what he's already laid out in Romans chapter 5. If Romans 5 demonstrates Adam is the federal head, but Jesus is a federal head, in 1 Corinthians 15, what Paul is doing is similar. Listen, in Romans 5, Adam, let's go to Romans 5, all right? Go to Romans chapter 5. Spiritually, Adam in Adam, that is, Adam as the cause, as the source, as the means. That's what Paul's doing about Christ in 1 Corinthians 15. In Christ, something's going to happen because in Christ is the means, he's the cause, and he's the source of something. In Romans 5, what we learn in verse 12, Romans chapter 5, verse 12, wherefore,
as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin. And so death passed upon all men, for that all have what? Sinned. And then Paul goes on, and not exclusively, but he begins to demonstrate, listen, there is a spiritual predicament that afflicts every human being. And it's called sin. And how many have sinned, according to Paul? A double hockey sticks, right? All. There's none righteous. No, not one. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. So there are spiritual consequences and ramifications because of Adam, okay? In Adam, in the sense, Adam, he did something. And as the federal head, whatever Adam achieved, guess what happens to everybody else? Well, what did Adam achieve? Verse 12. Wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and what? Death by sin. So Paul now is going to focus on the spiritual ramifications, okay? In 1 Corinthians 15, so before I go any further, according to Romans 5, how did Jesus counter the devastating effect of Adam's sin and, by extension, the sins of all humanity, sin and death, sin and death, sin and death, okay? Jesus, he countered it by dying on that cross, and because of his spiritual achievements, Jesus is a federal head. What it is he accomplished and what it is he's achieved, which is righteousness. Adam achieves death, sin and death. Jesus, he achieves righteousness. Look there at verse 17. For if by one man's offense death reigned by one, much more they which receive the abundance of grace and of the gift of what? Righteousness. Jesus counters the evil of Adam's sin, which again, as the federal head, sin enters into the world, and death by sin, for all have sinned. You know what Jesus does? He brings in righteousness. And of course, how? He achieves righteousness by dying on that cross and making it available to the sinner, okay? So my point in Romans 5 is there's the spiritual ramification. But what's Paul focusing in on in 1 Corinthians 15? Remember, Paul, he's not so much focusing in on the spiritual consequences of sin and death and how Jesus brings in righteousness and offers it, by the way, as a free gift. It's a free gift principle, right? In 1 Corinthians 15, verse 22, for as in Adam. Now, what does it mean in Adam? Look at verse 21. For since by man. In other words, when Paul's arguing in Adam, he's talking about by way of what Adam did. The idea in Adam, for example, right now, has to do with how it is he's done something in virtue, in what he procured, in what Adam procured for all of humanity. And what is it? All die. Paul then continues, even so. You see what Paul's doing? Paul is not saying only those in Christ will be made alive, but rather in Christ as the source and the means. God's going to counter what Adam did. What did Adam do? He sinned, death by sin. As verse 21, for since by man, okay, because of what he did, the effect, considering what Adam did, everybody dies. Verse 22, for as in Adam all die, even so, see that? In precisely the same manner, Jesus is going to counter the universal devastating effect of sin and death in Adam. Adam's the cause. Jesus is the cause. He's the reason. He's the effect that results in all humanity being raised from the dead. Now, we're going to ask the question, why? And we'll answer. I hope we're going to answer the question, why does everybody have to be raised from the dead? Jesus is going to tell us that, okay? So, the end of verse 22, even so, again, there's this equal countering tactic employed by Jesus Christ. Even so, in Christ shall all be made alive. In Adam do all die, believer and unbeliever, correct? Listen, I'm in Christ. Again, using the analogy, I am in positional, spiritual union with my living head, Jesus Christ. My identity is absorbed into his identity. And I'm going to be raised from the dead. But why do I have to die? Why do I have to die? Well, because Adam, I'll say it this way, screwed it up. When I say Adam screwed it up, am I implying I would have done a better job? No, I would have screwed up too, because I know who I am. I would have screwed up too. Okay, so when I say Adam screwed, what I'm getting at is in Adam as the cause. All die, I don't care if you're a believer or not. If you're a believer, I don't care how righteous a believer you are, it's appointed on a man, you're going to die. Why? Because that was the result of Adam. So what Paul is saying, you see what happens in Adam? In Christ as the cause and the source, guess what? Believer and unbeliever will be made alive, resurrected from the dead, okay? Now, here is one passage. There are a number of we can go to some verses to demonstrate that in Christ does not always mean in positional union with, but rather it has to do with what God's going to do, Jesus Christ being the cause and the source. Just one verse that I think illustrates this wonderfully because, and you'll see why. Go to Acts chapter 17, okay? Acts chapter 17. Acts chapter 17, Paul, in the context, he goes to Athens, right? We got to start at verse 23, okay? Acts chapter 17, verse 23. For as I passed by and beheld your devotions, I found an altar with this inscription, to the unknown God, whom therefore ye ignorantly worship, him I declare unto you. Now notice what Paul's going to do here. Because in correlation to what we're talking about regarding resurrection, just notice what Paul does. Verse 24, God that made the world, and all things therein, physical or spiritual. Well, for right now, God created the physical universe, did he not? And he certainly created all things therein. Okay, the plants, the birds, so on and so forth. Okay, seeing that he is Lord of heaven and earth, dwelleth not in temples made with hands, neither is worshipped with men's hands, as though he needed anything, seeing he, now notice, giveth to how many? All life and breath and all things. Does that include unbelievers? By the way, isn't Paul talking to a bunch of rank unbelievers? They're a bunch of idol-worshipping, you know, Gentiles. They're worshipping gold and silver and idols and objects and so on and so forth. So what is Paul doing? By the way, this is a real instructive strategy when you're dealing with a lost person, okay? So wait a minute. Verse 25, God, he giveth life, he giveth to all life. Does he only give life to the believer? No, he gives all humanity, and breath and all things. Verse 26, and hath made of one blood all nations. Is that restricted to the believer? No. Hath made of one blood all nations of men for to dwell on the face of the earth. And hath determined the times before appointed and the bounds of their habitation. Now look, let's just drop into verse 28. For in him we live. Now look at that expression, in him. Is Paul saying only those that are in him live? Or is he saying in him everybody lives? But in what sense? This is what I'm getting at. Appreciate verse 28. In him, we, and he's talking to unbelievers. So when we think about in him, in Christ, in the Lord, don't think of it as positional union restricted to the believer, but think of it as God is the originator of what? All life. All creation, believer and unbeliever, is accountable and responsible to who? The Creator. Verse 28, in him. You don't get in him to live. In him, the source, the cause, we live. Now, you see how Paul is dealing with the lost person? He's not saying, you bunch of dodos, and, you know, he's saying, let's think about creation. By the way, it is interesting. Paul talks about creation. There's a reason for that, Romans chapter 1, okay? Verse 28, for in him we live and move and have our being, as certain also of your own prophets have said, for we are also his what? In what sense? Now, by the way, this is not a verse to teach the fatherhood of God. In what sense are lost people the offspring of God? By the way, Ephesians is very clear. A lost person is a child of wrath, a child of disobedience, okay? But a lost person is the offspring of God. Now, you talk about being unsettled. In what sense is a lost person, an unbeliever, the offspring of God? Verse 29, for as much then as we are, he's talking to the unbeliever, the offspring of God, we ought not to think that the Godhead is like unto gold, silver, but when Paul looks at the lost person and says, we're the offspring of God, is he talking about being the spiritual children of God? He's talking about being the result of God's creative purpose. He's talking about the physical creation of humanity. And why is that important to tell a lost person? Because if God created you, who are you accountable to? The one who created you. That's what Paul's getting at. In him, we, unbeliever and believer, live. He created it. Does a lost person get to breathe the same oxygen you're breathing? Now, sometimes I wish Kyle wasn't sharing my oxygen, but I'm just kidding. You understand? Does God say, wait a minute, only the believer gets to drink water out of the tap? Only the believer gets to breathe. By the way, ultimately, does God own everything? Why does he let unbelievers share in the air and in the food and in the drink and in the blessings of God? God, who created this universe in such precise engineering. You know, unbelievers enjoy the physical bounty and the physical blessings of a physical creation as much as a believer. God doesn't discriminate. God never says only believers get to enjoy the fruits of my creative genius in the universe. Unbelievers get to enjoy it too, right? Now, sadly, professing themselves to be wise, they become fools. And they can actually look at the creative genius of God and then conclude he doesn't exist. Boy, you know what? They're going to be raised up from the dead and they're going to stand and explain to the Creator why you don't exist. Can you imagine that? Okay, pal. Give me your best argument why I don't exist. You know? By the way, they're going to come up with some stupid arguments. I can't. Anyway, so verse 29. For as much then as we, so this is not the doctrine of the fatherhood of God. He's not saying every person is a child of God. He's saying every person is the result of God's creation. Okay? Why is Paul bringing that up? Verse 31. Why is Paul bringing that up in dealing with a lost man? Verse 31. Because he hath appointed a day in the which he will judge the world in righteousness by that man whom he hath ordained, whereof he hath given assurance unto all men, in that he hath what? Raised him from the dead. Think about what Paul's doing. When Paul says, in Christ, all shall be made alive. Every person, unbeliever included, is going to be raised up and give account to Jesus Christ, the judge. That's why Jesus is raising up that lost person. You're going to give account to me, pal. Now look at verse 32. And when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some mocked, and others said, "We will hear thee again of this manner." Look at verse 34. "Howbeit certain men clave unto him and what? Believed." That's encouraging, right? I mean, how many of you go out there sharing the gospel with people, Will, and you bet 100, you bet 1,000%? No. You know, you've had doors shut, you know, lost friends and been ridiculed and mocked. And I've shared some guy when we were out in Grant Park. Back then it was called Grant Park when I was young. And, you know, and some guy hit me in the chest. You know, I gave him a track. Next thing you know, he hits me in the chest. You know, I mean, you know what? So that's okay. You know, that's okay. But certain men clave. Some will believe, okay? That's all. Don't worry about it. God doesn't say you better have, you know, 90% success rate. He doesn't give us that, right? Just do it. Just do it. Anyway, so let's talk about Jesus raising up a lost person. Let's go, since we're in Acts, go to Acts chapter 24. Go to Acts chapter 24. Don't get unsettled. In Christ, not positional union, but rather the means and the source. Jesus is going to raise up a lost person. Not because he's given them a second chance, okay? There are some doctrines out there that suggest, I don't even want to talk about it, but, well, this is actually the second chance given to a lost person. There's nothing in the passage that suggests a lost person is given, quote, a second chance, okay? That's not why he's raising the lost person up from the dead. Acts chapter 24, verse 15. Now, therefore, I did say Acts 24, right? Okay, I need to, Acts 24, and notice verse 15. "And have hope toward God, which they themselves also allow, that there shall be a resurrection," here we go, "of the dead, both of the just and," what? "Unjust." Remember, there's a gap between there. Now, don't worry about this right now. That we know there's a resurrection for who? Just and unjust. The verse doesn't tell us at the same time. When we study the scriptures, lo and behold, you know what we're going to discover? Man, there's a period of time between the just resurrection and the unjust. In fact, we can precisely understand the gap. How long is it going to be? We now know it's 1,000 years, okay? My point is this. Why is God going to raise the dead of the unjust? So there is going to, in Christ shall all be what? Made alive. They're going to be resurrected, okay? Go to John chapter 5. Go to John chapter 5. I'm just going to quote to you Hebrews chapter 9, verse 27. "It is appointed unto man once to die, and after that," what? "Judgment." The answer to the question, why would Jesus raise up an unbeliever? To judge him. And this is why. John chapter 5 is going to explain why Jesus is going to raise him up for the purpose of judging them, okay? John chapter 5, and let's begin reading at verse 21, okay? John chapter 5, verse 21. "For as the Father raises up the dead, and quickeneth them." Now, those are two different issues, but don't worry for now. Now, look at the end of verse 21. "Even so the Son quickeneth whom he will. For the Father judgeth no man, but hath committed all judgment unto" who? "The Son." God the Father has the rightful capacity and authority to raise the dead. By the way, he did it back there with Elijah. There was a poor boy who died, and Elijah raises this kid up from the dead, okay? The Father says, you know, and there's a strategic reason for that, who better to be a judge than one of your own? In other words, judgment is going to be committed to the Son of Man. God has the right to judge a lost person. But who would be in a better position to judge a human being than one who is also a human being? You see, that lost person can look God in the eye and said, you have no capacity to even relate to me. What kind of a judge are you? You know, think about it. So if God the Father were to judge, who is immortal, you can't even describe God the Father as immortal because he never had a body, okay? You have God who's worshipped in spirit, and now he's going to judge a human being? What if God becomes a man, fully God, fully human, and now sits on that throne of judgment and begins to judge a lost person? Can the lost person say, you have no ability to relate to me? By the way, Hebrews says that Jesus was tempted in all points as we. That sends chills down my spine. No one can accuse God of being, you know, being in that ivory tower. So no, Jesus is going to sit there on the throne, and you know what? By the way, he will forever bear the scars. Can you think about that? I mean, think about that. You know what? A lost person's going to argue against Jesus, and Jesus can just say, "Listen, pal, I was one of you. I became flesh." I did it for you, man. You know, I did it for you. So just think about the tactical, the reasoning here. The Father says, I'm not going to do this. I'm going to let my Son do this, okay? So keep going here, all right? Verse 22, for the Father judgeth no man, but hath committed all judgment unto the Son, that all men should honor the Son, even as they honor the Father. He that honoreth not the Son, honoreth not the Father which hath sent him. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that heareth my word and believeth on him that sent me hath everlasting life, and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death unto life. Verily, verily, I say unto you, the hour is coming, and now is, when the dead shall hear the voice of the Son of God, and they that hear shall live. Wait a minute. Live in, what does that mean, live? In the context, the dead shall hear the voice of the Son of God. And they that hear shall what? Live. Spiritual life or physical life? Physical. Please keep the context. And we have to recognize the context because of what he's going to say in just a moment here, okay? Paul says, in Christ shall all be made alive. Jesus says, the dead shall hear the voice of the Son of God, and as a result, what's going to happen? They that hear shall live. They're going to be resurrected. Verse 26, for as the Father hath life in himself, so hath he given to the Son to have life in himself, and hath given him authority to execute judgment also, because he is the Son of what? Isn't that the righteous thing to do on God's part? Now remember, God can do this. But he says, nah, son, since you're a man, you're going to be in a position to judge men. Verse 28, marvel not at this, for the hour is coming in which all that are in the graves shall hear his voice, and shall come forth they that have done good unto the resurrection of life, physical life, bodily resurrection, and they that have done evil unto the resurrection of what? Damn. In Christ all shall be made alive. That's what Paul's referring to. And the reason he does that is to demonstrate that Jesus has the rightful authority to do that, because the Father said, I'm giving you that authority because you're the Son of Man. And in light of what Paul's doing in 1 Corinthians 15, he's demonstrating that's how Jesus is going to defeat death ultimately at the great white throne judgment. The one who sits there with the scars in his hands, who was the first fruits of resurrection, unbelievers are going to be raised from the dead. and don't in Christ, not because they're in Christ, but through the means and instrumentality of who? The Lord Jesus Christ. A couple of verses, go over to Daniel chapter 12, all right? Just a few more verses in that regard, and then we'll finish up, all right? Daniel chapter 12. Here's just one more verse, all right? And then we'll just stop. Daniel chapter 12. And notice verse 1, Daniel chapter 12, verse 1. And at that time shall Michael stand up, the great prince which standeth for the children of thy people. And there shall be a time of trouble such as never was since there was a nation, even to that same time, okay? Tribulation, all right? The time of Jacob's trouble. Daniel is not talking about you or me. Don't look for the Antichrist. You're wasting your time. Don't fret over, and I know I go online and there's a lot of garbage out there. It's a lot of dangerous stuff out there, right? We're not in the tribulational period, okay? And we don't have to fear ever being in the tribulational period. Keep reading, even to that same time, and at that time thy people shall be delivered, everyone that shall be found written in the book. Verse 2, and many of them that sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life, and some to shame and everlasting what? Contempt. In Christ all shall be made alive, all right? He's the Son of Man who was given the rightful authority to exercise judgment of the lost. That's why he's going to raise them up from the dead, all right? We'll stop. Father, again, we do thank you for your grace. We do thank you for your love. We thank you for the assurance that you give to us that we, as believers today, become the sons of God, eternally united in your Son. We thank you for the hope, certainly that blessed hope that you give to us. We're not part of that prophetic plan to pour out wrath against a Christ-rejecting world, against a world that is opposed to all that you're doing. We thank you that you've delivered us from that wrath to come. And again, as we examine the issues of resurrection, may we certainly understand the purposes of it. And as we gain that understanding, may we just certainly value your wisdom behind it. And we do ask in Christ Jesus' name. Amen.